Welcome to episode 27 of the movie Lighthouse, shining a light through the fog of film. My name's James.
I'm Laurie.
And I'm Wyndham.
Hello, guys.
Hello, sunshine.
How are we all today?
Very good, thank you.
Very good.
A bit cold outside, isn't it?
Yes.
Well, winter's come.
Yeah.
Autumn's
come. We're just admiring my wonderful garden. It's like modern art.
It's kind of a little bit jungly, Jumanji.
It is a bit like the jungle.
Something's going to come out the back.
Well, let's hope not, unless it's Columbo.
Could you imagine if Peter Falk came out the back? Just one more thing.
Oh.
Peter Falk. I love that.
Living
man.
At the bottom of my garden.
Yeah. It's a nice garden for a lighthouse. You've got to remember where we are.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a little garden on the rocks.
Yeah. But it's nice to have that.
Right. Well, should we just crack on?
Yeah.
Normal service has resumed after last month's episode, which you very kindly hosted.
Yeah, you're very welcome.
Yeah.
How was your Halloween? The actual night.
Did you get any feedback?
Halloween was really, really, really great fun. Feedback on the show? No, absolutely zip. Well, and maybe even our listeners went down. Fucking hell! I made some real effort on that.
No,
episode.
I thought it was very good. Well done.
Thanks, babe.
And Wyndham's kindly agreed to host in the new year.
I have.
Yeah. So,
As in personally host or physically host?
Is there a difference?
Yeah, because you're hosting.
Right. You mean, well, in the lighthouse?
Yeah.
Right.
So I'll host in the lighthouse. Are you asking me to do your job?
Yes.
Oh, Christ.
Yeah.
Yeah. Was it really that hard to get to that?
Yeah, it never occurred to me. That's what you were asking. I just thought you meant physically, are we going to do it in my lighthouse?
What?
Since when did you have your own lighthouse?
It's typical. Trans-dimensional thing.
Whoa.
Oh, right. Okay, well, yeah.
So I thought you could do the February edition, the loving for Valentine's.
Okay. Yeah, all right, perfect.
A special. We'll just have specials every single month now, I think.
Yeah. You haven't got another lighthouse, have you? You can't over illuminate a frontage. There's a certain limit.
Well, there's one light, isn't there?
Yeah, exactly, so it's fine.
Yeah, but yeah, all
right. Okay. Yeah. Right, well, should we crack on then?
Yeah.
It's 1974 this month.
It is.
Yeah. Back to the 70s.
Yeah.
It sounds like bit like that thing.
Yeah, baby.
I've noticed we haven't had any people writing in for ages.
Okay, shall we ask them to write
there
in?
There is a big gap on your
please
script.
Please write in.
Yeah.
Basically,
it's a waste of paper otherwise.
Anything you maybe like us to cover, anything that you've seen that's really cool that you want to recommend, anything that we've covered before, or anything offensive.
Well, not anything we've covered before.
Okay, maybe
yeah,
not
keep
that.
It current.
Okay, yeah.
Email us at themovielighthouse@gmail.com, Facebook at Movie Lighthouse.
And we are still on Twitter. You teetered with the idea of not pulling that away, but we're still on Twitter.
Yeah. I still don't really understand how Twitter works.
It's just like sausages.
I'm not on it anymore.
Yeah.
We did get... I forgot to tell you. We got some mail.
Did
we?
Yeah. Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, here we are.
Via Instagram.
Okay.
Of all things.
Well, I'll insert...
So I don't get Instagram.
I'll insert the theme tune here.
How's it going?
There we go.
Was that the Instagram theme tune?
No, that's that male theme tune.
Oh, was it?
Yeah.
So, dear Lighthouse Keepers,
mm-hmm.
As an avid listener of the movie Lighthouse,
wow,
and as Wyndham's sister, wow. I felt the need to set the record straight. So she feels the need to set the record straight and robustly confirm that while Wyndham was catching snippets of Reanimator, I was most certainly not crocheting.
Damn it!
And Laurie needs a firm reprimand for the slander. Loving your work, guys. Please tell me you are going to have a little group trip to see Dr. Sleep and the long-awaited sequel to one of the greatest films ever.
Yes.
And we'll review it spoiler-free.
Yes.
Thanks, Megan.
Well, Megan.
Thanks, Megan.
Very good taste. And yes, we did do a group outing to see Dr. Sleep, but I was the only one who went.
Oh.
So
Why couldn't you go?
I was there in spirit.
Right. Why couldn't I go?
Because I went with Claudine, I think.
No,
you went.
That was
You went to Cornwall.
Ah, yes, I did.
They don't have cinemas down there.
No, I went to see Megan, actually.
Oh well, you should have gone together. Obviously, she's a big fan. Should we talk about it a little bit, or should we wait until you?
I think because we're on it, let's do it. Yeah. So you went to see it. On
I
your,
did.
With Claudine. Okay.
Yeah.
Spoiler free.
I thought it was very, very good indeed.
Yeah. Fantastic.
Yeah. I've read the book, so I knew kind of what to expect. But what I thought they did brilliantly was fuse Kubrick's The Shining with Stephen King's version of The Shining.
Because this is what you were most concerned about, wasn't it? That it was going to be too much Kubrick Shining, too much flashback, too much reliance on the love for the original.
Yes, looking at the trailer, you know, about a third of the trailer was like the original film.
Yeah, references to Kubrick's The Shining.
And in the book, there isn't the room for as many references for a reason which I can't go into.
Because this is the thing, it was probably about a couple of years ago the book came out, and you was telling me kind of about the premise of what the book is. And when you was explaining it to me, I was like, what? That's absolutely nothing to do with The Shining. Like these guys going around in Winnebago.
Well, in hindsight, like I might have kind of misread it a little bit. Can I imagine they're all really old people because they're in Winnebagos? But they're kind of like vampires, really.
Yeah,
There is one thing that I had a real issue with, and we've talked about it before, and so there's a bit of a spoiler here, but there's a bit where basically Danny meets his father, who's basically a ghost now.
Right.
And they just really missed a trick, because in this day and age, they could have easily done that thing, deep fake, what is it?
You know. Oh, right, okay.
With,
so use Jack Nicholson. Computer.
And, yeah.
Maybe he said no.
Well, not possibly, but they got somebody who just, you know.
Was it Christian Slater?
If only. Yeah. It's just like a really poor man's version, and everything else fitted really well.
Well, look, listen, we've discussed this before. So when Rogue One came out, remember they used
Peter Cushing? Well, I've never been a fan of it, but that was a perfect reason to use it, I think.
You think?
Yeah.
But the guy looks like Jack Nicholson, right?
Yeah.
I think, well, I don't know, is it a bad call or not? I haven't seen it yet.
If that had been Nicholson, I think it would have been near perfect for me, really.
I think it would be too much, though. Wouldn't it push you a little bit out of the film? Because you would be so surprised. Oh, wow, that's amazing computer graphics.
Now, you're more surprised when you're looking at it and go, well, it's not him.
Right, yeah, okay. I need to see it.
Yeah.
We like it. What would you give it out of 10?
Oh, I'd give it a 9, I think.
Goodness me.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
But, you know, it's a very different film than The Shining. Don't go in and expect anything like that. But, yeah.
But then the book is very different as well.
Yeah. All books tend to be, really.
No, those vampire werewolf books didn't seem to be that different.
Vampire werewolf?
Oh, Twilight.
Twiggy.
Yeah. Oh, right. Bloody hell.
Yeah. So we've actually got quite a good film with Ewan McGregor in it.
Yeah, but I think he makes quite a few good
films.
How's
his accent? Does he get over it quickly?
Yeah, it's just a little bit odd, really, but it's fine, you know. I don't know quite where he's supposed to be from, but I don't know. Maybe
he's traumatised. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. He doesn't know where he's from. He's had his personality split any which way but loose.
Yeah.
That's cool.
So we're recommending
Dr. Sleep. Go and watch it, kids. Go see it
at the cinema.
Good stuff.
Anyone else got any news?
I've got some news.
Oh, look at you two.
I found it the other day. Hold on. Just need to open up my news provision piece. Okay, so have you guys heard of a metadrama that Nicolas Cage is being linked to?
Oh, like
called
it already.
The Unbearable Weight of Massive Talent. In which he plays Nicolas Cage.
Oh, right? That's just great.
Do you want to hear a brief synopsis?
How can people not like him?
Yes, please. Oh. Yeah.
Okay. So, Cage, so this is kind of Hollywood Reporter current hot topic.
Yeah.
If deals close, Cage would star as actor Nicolas Cage. The character is desperate to get a role in a new Tarantino movie while also dealing with a strained relationship with his teenage daughter. He also occasionally talks to an egotistical 1990s version of himself who rides in for making too many crappy movies and for not being a star anymore.
Love it.
The Cage character is also under a mountain of debt and finds himself forced to make an appearance at the birthday party of a Mexican billionaire who happens to be a fan of Cage's work and secretly hopes to show him a script on which he's been working. While he bonds with the man, Cage is informed by the CIA that the billionaire is actually a drug cartel kingpin who has kidnapped the daughter of a Mexican presidential nominee and was recruited by the US government to get intelligence. The situation spirals even more dramatically when the Mexican brings over Cage's daughter and his ex-wife for a reconciliation, and when their lives are on the line, Cage takes on the role of a lifetime. I have to see that film.
I think it's going to be my favourite film of all time already.
Look at that.
Yeah, brilliant. Definitely going to go and see that as a little trip.
So let's hope everybody can get their shit together and get that made.
Yeah, yeah.
Is it not being made?
So it's at the point where Cage is apparently attached.
Right.
He's now...
Well,
some bloke
needs to be, I suppose.
Some bloke wrote it, sent it to him with a letter, cover letter, saying, please read this. Don't take offence that there's a bit of piss taking in here, but it is a love letter to you.
Brilliant.
And he's now apparently on board, and they're trying to. They've got multiple producers or studios or whatever trying to get their claws into it, apparently.
And what's the title of it again?
Oh, I just closed it.
The Weight of Being.
It is.
Freaking Awesome or something.
It is. Come on. The Unbearable Weight of Massive Talent.
Looking forward to that. Oh. I've got a little bit of news.
I'll go on.
So, the amazing Alan Moore.
Yeah.
He's announced that he's retiring.
Oh. Mm.
So, his last little sort of swan song to culture will be the last episode of The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, which is due to come out at the end of this month. We're currently in November. So that would be The Tempest.
You mean the graphic novel?
The graphic novel. So that's volume 4.
Yeah.
Now, I appreciate, obviously, this is the movie Lighthouse, and we're talking about movies, and I'm now talking about, like, this you know.
And the movie version of that was awesome.
But, you know, Alan Moore's a massive influence on film, on story, on culture, and all that stuff. So I think it's worth shouting out. But apparently he is retiring, but hopefully not.
He looks like a roadie, doesn't he?
He does, yeah.
Like a heavy metal roadie.
Yeah, and he's got very wide reach. He's got very long arms.
So he can carry the amplifiers?
Exactly, yeah. He could have like 2 Vox amplifiers, piece of piss. But yeah, I'm hoping him retiring is not because he's down on shit, you know?
Maybe it's because he's old.
Yeah, I'm hoping it's basically that. Because things are a bit weird and a bit shit at the minute. And I'm hopefully... You know,
you think he's been brought down by Brexit?
Oh, I don't know. I don't know. But yeah, there's that. You got some?
Yes, I do. There is a new Uzumaki adaptation on its way.
What's Uzumaki, James?
Well, it
sounds
is...
Sounds like a soup.
Oh, it's fucking awesome.
Again, it's a graphic novel by...
Oh, Ichō no Kuyo. It's a manga.
Yeah. And it's all about a spiral, basically, and how it can infiltrate people's lives and, like, fuck everybody up.
It's a Japanese comic book manga, all right?
You have to read it backwards with them.
You do?
Do you really?
Yeah.
As in physically backwards, or you start at the end of the story and
you start at the end of the
beginning?
No, physically backwards.
Okay.
Because that's the way Japanese reading goes. Yeah, it goes that way. but yeah, so yeah, you're in this little town in Japan, aren't you? And then this...
Although you don't read it all backwards, do you? So if you're on the page, you read it normal
you
ways.
You start on the top.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So... They got that wrong, didn't they?
They did.
It's like a half-hearted effort.
Yeah. Anyway, sorry, go on.
You get the gist. So now you're in this sort of like beautiful kind of idyllic little town in Japan, beautiful, but slowly but surely this spiral starts creeping into everything. So, I don't know.
Thank you for just saying what I just said.
Yeah, exactly that. But that spiral starts infiltrating people's minds and stuff like that, and people get weirder and weirder,
yes.
Turning into snails, turning into typhoons. All sorts of crazy. It's a great, great horror comic.
And they made a film of it, didn't they?
They did make a film.
It was live action, wasn't it?
It was it was a film.
Yeah, but so is Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. But that's not live action, is it?
Okay.
What I'm saying is this version's going to be animated.
Oh, okay. Even greater, because obviously there's some really great imagery.
Yeah, because some of the film didn't work, really.
Yeah, it would be really hard, because the imagery, the ideas are really, really far out.
Yeah, like a spiral going in someone's head.
Yeah, but they could have just got the guy who did Hustle.
Yes, they could.
They could have done. But, now that's very exciting.
Jungle Book for Japanese version of Jungle Book, as opposed to the Japanese version of Jaws.
Yes. It's not Jaws. When's that due to come
In the new year, I think.
Oh,
Four brilliant. Parts.
That is very good news.
And is that four feature-length parts?
Well, I don't know all the ins and outs with them.
Okay.
I imagine it'll be about half an hour to 45 minutes.
Based on?
Just guessing.
Okay.
Right, okay, so I remember a couple of episodes back I did say, tomorrow, War of the Worlds is going to be on BBC.
And tomorrow...
I'm going to say, tomorrow, War of the Worlds with Eleanor Tomlinson, Rafe Spall, Robert Carlyle will be on the BBC
Wow,
telly.
So Sunday is a fun day for it's TV, isn't it, at the moment?
Sunny.
I love this
I'm a celebrity, get me out of here's comeback.
Yeah, yeah. Oh. No, that's all. That's
no,
all,
but I'm
all.
Talking about obviously his Dark Materials.
His Dark Materials. So we're two episodes in. Third one will be tomorrow. Are you enjoying it?
Loving it.
Me too.
Yeah, you're, very good.
Yeah, really, really good. I think Pullman's. He's actually there, isn't he? And he's consulting on the thing. They've made some changes with the book. So there's a dude
They're bringing in elements from other
from
later
the
on.
They're tiring it in. Yeah, and obviously because he's there.
Tiring it in.
But because he's there, you know, this is going to... It's all trusted. I'm really...
Oh, it's a very good adaptation, is it?
Yeah.
It reminds me of, you know, when they did The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe back in the
80s. Yeah.
But a lot better.
Yeah. And I think Ruth Wilson, is it?
Yeah, she's great.
She is a perfect Mrs. Coulter.
Yeah. Right.
She's got a funny mouth.
Common or posh?
The actress?
Well, when you're looking at her... We know Mrs. Coulter's posh. Could I was with my friend Ashley, who's a big fan of the show. Hi, Ash.
Hi, Ashley.
Hi, Ashley.
And I was watching it, and I said, oh, God, she looks really common. And Ash went, no, she looks really posh. So I'm interested to know what your thoughts are.
I think it's probably her mouth. She's got a unique mouth.
I think she's...
Which tips to posh.
I think she is on the middle class to posh.
Okay. Must be me then.
Must be you then.
But it's very good. So just back to War of the Worlds. So this is a faithful adaptation, isn't it?
No, it's
set in Victorian.
It's set in Victorian, so that is faithful. But I think we're following characters where... So from the book... We had this scientist guy, I can't remember the character's name. Mm-hmm. So you follow him and it breaks to his brother. This one, I think we've got two lovebirds and we're following their story.
Right, okay. All right.
I wouldn't be surprised if we do bump into the character who's in the original novel kind of thing. But yeah.
As long as we don't bump into Tom Cruise.
Yeah, as long as he's not there. There's some good bits in that, but that's not good.
But, yeah.
It's not
a
good.
Terrible ending, that book.
The book?
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah. Real cop-out.
The solution
is, yeah.
is like, oh, I'm so tired of writing this book.
No, yeah. I really love the ending. So we're talking about...
Oh, okay.
Apparently.
That's what we're talking about.
Ruined it for people who haven't... Don't know it. But
I love the ending.
You might need to put a...
Oh, no.
Common cold.
Okay.
Common cold.
But yeah, that should be good.
If that genuinely was... What time of year did they invade?
Oh, good.
So if it was around about now,
yeah,
they'd only last about 5 minutes.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it was around the summer months. May. I don't know, can't remember.
The reason I don't like it as an ending is it's one of those things that doesn't matter what any of the characters do, it's not about their fight and, you know, trying to defend the planet. It's about a completely external factor, so it doesn't matter... At all.
Which is great.
Well, maybe. Kind of takes away the point of the film.
Write in and let us know. Is it a great ending or not? Super quick one. I know it's not a film. But however, I highly, highly, highly recommend you checking out...
you haven't recommended any films,
yet. Eight-part series on Netflix called Marianne. Creepy as hell. It's a French production. Basically, it's about this famous writer. And she's lured back to her childhood... home, as it were, and basically the reason why she's a famous writer, she's been writing like these ghost stories, but all the stuff that she's been writing about is actually coming into reality, and you learn about her and why these stories are in her and why they are coming to reality. There's some great scenes in it. It's creepy as hell.
Do you have to
great
read it?
Production. No,
it's not subtitled.
Oh, yes, you do have to read it. Sorry. Yeah, you do have to read it. But it's really good, Marianne. Okay. Really, really good and creepy.
Huh. Did anyone ever watch the second series of... what was it called? Where all the dead came back to life.
The Returned?
Yeah, Le Revenu or something.
Yeah.
Did anyone see the second series?
Yeah, we
all loved the first series.
First series really great. Second series, I think it had problems with kind of making sense of itself, but right. It was still good.
Okay.
Lick Pub.
The Lick Pub.
Lick Pub. That was okay.
Right, when got anything else?
No.
Laurie.
The whole page of stuff
in. No, well, my other one was just the Mark Kermode's Fear of God is currently on iPlayer. So if you're a fan of The Exorcist and you've not seen
it's on that for ages,
God,
apparently,
you have to go and watch The Fear of God. It's a documentary about The Exorcist. And basically, Kermode, obviously a massive fan of the film, he just basically just sets up the scenes. I think it was made in early 90s. He sets up the scene, it gives you a bit of context about the film, but then it breaks away to all the people that actually made the film, and they talk about it. Some really great stories, some quite profound stuff in there as well. But Fear of God, currently an iPlayer, I highly, highly recommend you checking that out.
All right, well, yeah. Great. Okay, well, let's go on to In the Beam, shall we?
Okay.
All right, so who wants to kick us off?
I'm happy to.
Yes, brilliant.
And this perfectly links to my piece of news. And I came across the piece of news after I'd seen this film and decided it was going to be my In the Beam.
It's Cage news.
You look very excited.
It is Cage news. And it is a film called Kill Chain.
Kill Chain!
It's a 2019 release. It's obviously got Nicolas Cage in it. It's got Annabella Acosta.
I've never heard of this. This boy is busy.
Yeah, he is. It's got Ryan Quanten, who played the sheriff in True Blood. You know, the young, ripped guy. He's finally got another job, which is nice. Enrico Colantoni, Angie Sapida, loads of people in it. Mm. It is basically the story of a hitman.
Yeah.
It's a revenge story, and it is almost entirely set within this little Mexican hotel. And it's a Mexican hotel with a massive atrium in the middle of it.
Yeah.
Typically where atriums are, but in the middle of it, so it kind of goes up the height of the hotel. And Nicolas Cage plays the hotelier, and shit comes to his hotel. There's a few hits going on outside of it, and then a couple of people turn up, a woman, and it's basically just this domino effect of one hitman and another and another and another and another, and it all just kind of spiraling into this kind of final.
We're in the atrium the whole way through.
Almost the whole way through.
Brilliant.
But it's probably about 90% set in this hotel.
Okay. Oh, wonderful.
What's it called again?
It's called Kill Chain.
Never heard of it. And that's just come
out. Just out this year, yeah.
And what did you watch it on?
I can't remember whether it was Amazon Prime or Netflix.
So do we kind of, what we got here is potentially a play, right? This could easily be done in a theatre.
Could be.
Yeah,
but it's good. They made the film. Why go see it?
Well, no, because just that containment stuff. I love films like, you know, 12 Angry
Men. You know, theatre doesn't work like that. You know, you don't have to do a story that just fits on the stage.
Well, I like it. I like it. But no, I like those kind of films where you're contained to kind of one environment and that all it. Yeah.
And it's Nicolas Cage showing a bit of restraint.
Oh, is it Cage?
Interesting. Can you hear the Salvation Army down the road? Yeah. Practicing?
Is it real? Well, I think it's the neighbours. I don't think it'll be picked up on it. All right, have you got anything?
In the Beam. So you mentioned quite a while ago, Wyndham, you shouted out a film made by Matthew Holness, a.k.a. Darth Merengue.
Oh, okay.
That dude, and he is a dude! I love him! The shit he likes, I kind of like. Anyway, he went away and
except for that guy. Who talks like that all the time?
No, I like him. Matt Berry. Okay. I love Matt Berry. But yeah, Matthew went away and obviously made this, apparently, seemingly, obviously to me, a labour of love, a film called Possum.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You shouted it out a while ago in the news. Has either of you seen it? Have you either of you seen it? Okay, so Halloween. My Halloween, yeah.
Okay.
Finally got round to see it.
Just checking. And,
It's just a really, really, really good film. I think I potentially it's not for everyone's taste, but if you've got your cine salts, your cinema salts, as it were, your film salts, you're going to enjoy it. It's kind of it's basically focusing on this guy who has had a trauma, obviously, in his childhood. And he's still...
Ooh.
He's laboured with that trauma. And that's,
sorry, we're looking at the poster as opposed to listening to Laurie try to explain what it's about.
We're looking at the poster now, everyone. And basically, you've got a bag and this big kind of sort of spider thing coming out of it. So you meet this character and he's walking around literally with his baggage. And this baggage is that trauma. And he comes back to his hometown and he goes back to this house where obviously this trauma must have happened. But the whole film is very sort of dreamlike, symbolic in a way, because like the bag obviously being that kind of symbolism of his baggage, and throughout the film many times he tries to get rid of it, but then the next minute he wakes up and it's right there again.
Mm.
And inside this bag is that trauma, but it's linking back to sort of late 70s, early 80s. So you've got... Well, stop putting me off of this goddamn poster.
Now we're reading the synopsis, sorry.
Yeah, sorry, go on.
But yeah, it's...
You haven't mentioned he's a puppeteer.
A disgraced children's puppeteer.
Well, yeah, I didn't get that. When I watched it, I didn't get the disgraced puppeteer bit. I just thought, you know, he's gone back to this trauma of his. But it cuts back to this character, but I believe his uncle or a relative that he obviously lived with, played by Alan Armstrong, and fucking hell, there's something about him that I recognise. I never had trauma. I had a beautiful childhood, but just his acting, I know that kind of character. I obviously must have experienced that kind of character, or I don't know, something in that period of our childhood where, I don't know, we didn't really, you know, like the Gary Glitter stuff, you know, Jimmy Savile stuff,
yeah,
you know, all that. We were.
I did affect every child in the 80s.
Oh, no, I know. But I just... There's a certain quality about the film that I kind of recognise. It's kind of weird.
And that's on Netflix, is it?
It is. I found it on the Sky. But the acting is fantastic. It's a beautifully crafted film. The music is done by the radio... BBC Radiophonic Workshop.
Oh, wow.
Brilliant soundtrack. As I say, the acting is spot on. The debut, or whatever they call it, by Sean Harris, who plays the main character. He's freaking amazing. And yeah, it's not a nice subject matter, but it's a really, really good little film.
Sean Harris, he plays the bad guy in the Mission Impossible films.
Oh, really?
All of them?
Yeah. Well, not all of them, but it's not his debut.
Oh, okay.
He's done loads.
Rewind and bleep that out, will you, James?
It's about 20 films, there.
Yeah, he's solidly been working for years.
For years.
I mean, he's done really well. He's had a great career.
Oh, okay. Well, he's got really good.
He's had 3 wins and 4 nominations for awards, hasn't he? Anyway.
Right, thank you very much.
Possum.
Okay, so mine is a film with Tom Hiddleston and Tilda Swinton.
Swinton.
Yeah. Only Lovers Left Alive. Mm. Have you seen this?
No.
Okay, so it's a vampire film.
Oh, right.
But without really any of the elements of them being vampires, except they do need to drink blood. It's more about two people who live for an incredibly long time and how they kind of see the world differently because their understanding of time moves differently. When it started, I thought, a load of pretentious twaddle.
Yeah.
And I nearly turned it off after 20 minutes, but after about 25 minutes, I realised how much I liked it.
Ah.
And it was just...
What made you bridge that 5 minutes? Because you strike me as... And I've known you a long time. You strike me as that man at 20 minutes, you go, like, fuck this.
Yeah, I just don't think I can bother choosing.
With the remote control. Yeah,
exactly.
I'm with you.
The attention to detail for the set and the design was beautiful, but also... yeah, just an excellent script and wonderfully acted. So, yeah, I highly, highly recommend it.
See, bloody vampires. I know that there's loads of routes that you can go down. I've said it 1,000 times, Salem's Lot is my one. Because it's a malevolent thing. You know, the minute you die, the vampire virus or whatever it is uses your lovers... Well, no, uses
it happens
your
with
form,
that. That happens with every vampire film.
Uses your
every
form
single
to
vampire film.
Lure the people that love you to open the window.
It's like one of the biggest traits of being a vampire.
But it's a malevolent, I'm going to fuck you up and I'm going to make you a vampire. However, you know, they do all this stuff where, oh, I'm just cursed with the virus and I have to live forever, but I'm still myself.
No, it's not like Twilight, this film.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They don't shine like a diamond.
Shine like a diamond. Right. Anyway, no, okay. Only lovers left alive.
Yes.
Okay.
Check it out. All right, on the rocks. Love on the rocks. Ain't no surprise. Right, now I did... You know we have a sound effect for that.
Yes, sir.
Do yours again?
No.
Go on.
Do you on rocks? What, do you play the on the rocks thing again? Love on the rocks. Ain't no surprise. That's much better than your one.
Yeah.
On the rocks is Neil Diamond singing Love on the Rocks. In the Beam because... Because light doesn't make a sound. Yeah. So I had
doesn't
to,
it?
No. Not usually. So,
I think you just need to open your mind a bit more.
Love man well, into America.
Is
that it? Out of bone, out of fade. Hitchhiker into America. God, I'm good at Neil. I never realised that.
You should do some.
Fuck.
Well, I had it on the rocks, and it wasn't really on the rocks. Because I liked the film, but I wanted to talk about it, but I never wrote it down, so I can't remember for the life of me what it was. And I was kind of cheated anyway, so...
Something's on the rocks.
Nothing from me.
I totally forgot about the on the rocks feature, so I'm sure I've seen something shit, but I can't remember what it might be.
Okay.
I have.
You don't. If it's Marvel, don't even bother.
Why would it be Marvel?
It's always fucking Marvel. Review?
No, it's not.
All right, okay, go on then.
What Marvel film has he not liked?
I said Dark Phoenix was shit because it pretends to focus on Jean Grey, but it's
not
actually
really Marvel,
about
is it? I wouldn't
is that DC?
Oh, I don't care.
No, it's just not made by Marvel Studios.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Anyway.
Go on.
This is a film called Automata.
Ooh.
All right? Because you made the comment, you sent us a note saying that about 99% of our choices are horror, and we are not just about horror. So I thought, hey, this is a bit of sci-fi.
I think I said good.
You did say 80%. So I watched a film called Automata, which has got Antonio Banderas.
You have to say that name very quickly, by the way.
Antonio Banderas.
That's better.
Birgit Hjort Sorensen, Dylan McDermott, Melanie Griffith, some people like that. And it's basically a really poor, low-budget version of all the kind of automaton AI stories out there. So... when do machines stop being just machines and when do they develop personalities?
Right, yeah. An ancient story.
Yeah, exactly. And it's all that kind of, the Philip K. Dick.
Yeah, absolutely.
Invented those, I think he invented them, I may be wrong, but he invented those kind of laws of automatons to stop them taking over humans. And so they can't, through an act of omission, allow a human to be hurt, all those kind of things. So this has... the two laws and...
Like Robocop.
A little bit like all of that stuff, yeah. But it's just a bit shit. And it's kind of like a little bit... the shit version of Judge Dredd, where the world is fucked and it's just got little cities encased in big walls and...
Mm.
It's just really poo. And Antonio Banderas plays an insurance adjuster.
It's not a very exciting job, is it?
But he's an insurance adjuster for the company that has the monopoly on making these automatons. So it's a little bit like iRobot.
Right.
That if these robots malfunction, then the company's responsible for all these kind of bits and pieces. But they start off by kind of saying, after the war or the sandstorm or the whatever it was that caused the destruction of mankind... There's like a tenth of the global population survive.
Like at the start of Terminator 2.
Start of Terminator 2, start of bloody Blade Runner. It's just trying to be... It's taken a lot of references from elsewhere, but it basically says there's a lot of technology regression.
Right.
Which is an excuse for not having the budget to make the androids look good.
Yeah.
And it's just really, as I said, a poor version of a story we've seen a thousand times.
We've seen it all before, and yep. Okay, bless them. Okay.
And but for the fact that Antonio Banderas is just, his voice is amazing.
Into the middle of the years. What I want to know is, are you more than just a robot?
Yeah.
It's that kind of stuff. But it's just not worth it. Okay. Automata.
So, okay. Keep away from that one.
Oh, bless him. Right. So what have we got? 1974, James.
1974.
Lighthouse.
Do you want to tell us about it? Okay, so let me give you a little bit of information about 1974. Now, I think this was pre-internet 1974, because it was very hard for me to find any information about it.
Just send the pigeon.
There was a bit of a blip. But in the news, the IRA begins its bombing campaign.
Right.
And Nixon resigned. Mm. Popular culture, not much. Can find anything that happened in 1974. Although, on television, Bagpa starts.
Oh!
And Tom Baker becomes Doctor Who.
Oh! Can you have just the bagpuss?
Yes.
Upon a time, not so long ago, there was a little girl, and her name was Emily.
Thank you so much. We all needed that. Didn't we need that?
Definitely.
We needed that.
Because when Bagpuss goes to sleep, all the mice go to sleep.
Right, the music was hard as well, but the Carpenters, the hits, seemed to be the most popular.
You bring up the Carpenters.
Well, I don't know if I'm using the wrong search engines, but I found it quite challenging.
Just use the pigeon.
Who died? Really boring. Well, no, that's offensive. Oscar Schindler, not a boring person at all. And Cass Elliot, Mama Cass Elliot.
Mama Cass.
Yep. Top five grossing films. We had Earthquake, Young Frankenstein.
Yes!
The Trial of Billy Jack.
Right. Never heard of.
The Towering Inferno and Blazing Saddles.
Great film.
Yeah. What? Blazing Saddles and Young Frankenstein came out the same.
Well, apparently.
Busy year.
I think maybe Blazing Saddles was the year before.
Well, it says here, highest grossing films of 1974.
Yeah, you and your search engine. Young Frankenstein, such a great film.
Terrible musical.
Just quickly, just to mention, other films that came out in 1974, The Conversation, Francis Ford Coppola, amazing, go and watch that. We did Woman Under Influence, John Cassavetes film, really, really cool. Taken of Pelham... One, two, three. Really great. The Phantom of the Paradise.
Oh.
Yay! Bring Me the Head of Alfredo Garcia. Really cool film. And The Godfather Part 2. So it's quite cool year.
Yet we chose. All right, so we're going to start with the Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
Okay.
So let's have a clip.
What happened was true. The most bizarre and brutal series of crimes in America.
All right, so let me give you some facts about this film. It was released in 1974. Director, Tobe Hooper.
Yes!
Screenplay, Kim Henkel and Tobe Hooper. Budget of $140,000.
Fuck all.
And, again, I'm not sure if this is completely reliable, but it says the box office, maybe it's to date, it's made £235 million. It seems an awful lot of money.
That's definitely today. But quite quickly, it was, I think it's 70.
Huh?
70 million.
How do you know?
Because I sent the pigeon.
Oh, great.
I didn't use your search engine.
Okay, it's had a, it's spawned a few sequels and spin-offs. Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2 in 1986.
Which is also done by Tobe Hooper. And the only reason why he was allowed to make that is because, you know, Life Force, a film that we covered.
Yes. Yeah.
Brilliant film, bonkers film.
Not brilliant, but when, go on.
Well, when they gave him Space Vampires, they said, okay, if you make this film, we will give you three more films. We'll allow you to, well, another two films. So yeah. Part of a three-film deal. And he said, okay, can I make Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2 in that? And they went, absolutely. So that's why we've
wow.
Which is really good.
And then in 1990, we had the Texas Chainsaw Massacre 3, Leatherface.
Which was not made by Tobe Hooper.
In 1995, we had Texas Chainsaw Massacre, The Next Generation.
God.
In 2003, we had the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, so that was a reboot. And then, if that wasn't enough, in 2006, we had the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, The Beginning.
There you are.
Yeah. And then, January the 4th, 2013, we had Texas Chainsaw 3D.
Brilliant.
And then we had Leatherface as well, I think. Or
there's like 10 of them, aren't there?
Yeah. I think it's a Lord of Diminishing Returns as well.
Mm. I think fuck all that shit. Actually, I haven't seen them, but 1 and 2 are good.
Okay, so Marilyn Burns played Sally. Alan Danziger played Jerry. Paul A. Partain played Franklin. William Vale, Kirk, Terry McKinn, Pam. Edward Neal, the hitchhiker. Jim Sido, the proprietor. Gunnar Hansen, Leatherface. John Duggan, Grandpa Sawyer. And John Larroquette was the narrator.
Narrator?
Mm.
Yeah.
Narrator?
There's a narrator at the beginning, isn't
there? I think so.
Oh, yeah. Of course there is. Yeah. Yes. Okay, so who's going to synopsis this sucker?
Well, you are, obviously. It's back to normal.
For fuck's sake. So we've got five kids in a Volkswagen camper.
Is anybody else see that thinking Mystery Machine?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ooh. I don't know. Yeah, that's good.
Pretty good, right? Let's get out of here, Scoops! Pretty good?
Yeah,
pretty good.
Diamond's better, though, isn't it?
Okay, so you haven't managed to do the synopsis.
So they're in the camper van, and driving along, having a great time. One of them's in a wheelchair.
They're not having a great time.
Franklin.
No, Franklin is whinging and moaning because it's so hot.
He's slightly annoying, isn't he? But I love him.
He's the clever one. He must have been one of the most frustrated. Disability awareness anywhere in the 70s was next to...
Do you know what? I was going to talk about this later, but...
But he was fucking annoying.
Brilliant to have somebody, a wheelchair user, in the film in the 70s, because it was kind of unheard of.
Mm.
One of many, many awesome things about this film.
They made him into such an annoying, whiny fucking character.
Well, yeah, but you get a bit of insight into that. Anyway, so they're going along. They decide to pick up a hitchhiker. Whoa, this guy's off his tree.
Yeah.
He works in the local slaughterhouse, which Franklin in the chair and his sister are aware of because they used to live around these parts.
You've run out of time.
In their youth. And they've run out of gas. They're a little bit stranded, so they chill out in the house that they used to live in, Franklin and his sister.
Basically, they're getting embroiled with a really fucked up family.
Who work in the slaughterhouse, or kind of own the slaughterhouse, and one after the other, they get fucked up.
Yeah.
In a nutshell, five kids with a blatant disregard for their own self-preservation deserve to die having investigated a big spooky house.
Yeah, absolutely.
I really like Franklin. I think he's great.
All right, well, we'll get on to that in a minute. Right, so, anyone have any connections to the film?
You always ask this.
I know, it's a stupid question, but I always forget to check it out. Well, for me, Leatherface was one of the last horror movie icons that I found out about, really. So, you know, you've got Pinhead, Freddy, Jason, and Leatherface is one of those, like, in the gang, really.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I think he was the last one I came to. Mm. He was always a bit of a mystery, because I'd never seen the film.
So when did you, when did you first see it?
Well, I'm having to look at my notes again. About 17.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
So slightly later.
Yeah, I loved it. I thought it was brilliant.
When you first saw it.
Yeah, and I remember how much it kind of freaked me out.
Yeah.
Yeah, because... We'll talk about that later as well. How about you?
Well, when I first saw it, it was probably like early 20s. Again, like stuff started to come out on DVD. And I'm a bit pretentious. I like arty stuff. You know, I can take it. I can handle it. I can read into stuff. This film started opening up. And I thought it was just going to be, you know, a very famous, popular kind of horror slashy film that's going to be nasty. Right from the opening credits, like, this is not your normal, this is cool, this is great, this imagery is fucking awesome. That opening sequence of the flash,
yeah, flashlight, I'd forgotten completely about that
on the corpse
sequence.
And then you pull back and you see this weird sort of corpse sculpture thing, and you're hearing the radio going on,
they've been
talking
grave
about
robbers,
graves being, yeah, yeah, dug up as it were, and then it breaks into this freaking awesome music, and you've got like the sun, you've got like the flares of the sun,
yeah,
bursting. It's like, wow, this is awesome. And then you obviously, then you go into the camper van Scooby Doo stuff, but it's just, it's, I was just kind of blown away about how cool the film is, really.
Yeah,
that's it.
How about you, Wim?
So I didn't see it as early as you guys did. I think I probably only saw it 15 years ago, something like that.
Mm. Did you watch it with your wife?
Almost certainly not. And I similarly, I remember it being, having, so I've only seen it once before rewatching it for this.
Yeah.
And I remember it being significantly scarier than I, and I, obviously I know what's going to happen.
Yeah.
But I also remember it being, I think I remember it being a bit gorier and a bit, whereas it,
well,
isn't that, I mean, it's pretty,
there's about,
the really kind of troubling scenes are not the scenes that are overtly violent and bloody and,
yeah, it's kind of what they do, isn't it? And I suppose from when you first saw it to watching it again, we've had the whole, what's it called? Gorno?
Oh,
you know. What? Oh, I've forgotten what it's called. What's
Gorno
called?
Sounds great. Let's go with that.
It sounds like a Muppets character.
But, you know, kind of having, you know, the nasty,
the Saw stuff.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But this is the thing, though. So you've touched on something there. So this film
torture
is
porn.
That's the one.
Stuff. Should we go with that? Okay.
That is a thing.
But you've touched on something there with the fact that the gore and all that. I mean, as an experience, this film is traumatic. It's hardcore. It's terrifying. You know, scary as hell. And you kind of come away thinking you've watched kind of a gory horror
film.
It's
stressful.
There's hardly any yeah. blood in it at yeah. all. There's probably about three or four smudges throughout the film. There's hardly any. And it's just that, that what Tobe Hooper's
you're,
done.
You're looking like a mime artist.
It's hard for me to speak and speak sense.
Yes.
But I'm just trying to get to that point. It's just that he's just so cleverly put this film together with just a terrifying experience where you're sure you've just watched people's heads being chopped off and chopped in half and arms being ripped up and all. But you haven't. You haven't actually seen any of that. He's just managed to give you this intense experience.
Well, about an hour of the film is just high stress all the way through, isn't it? It doesn't let up at all.
No.
I mean, so and as
especially
we,
as it's just one by one.
Yeah.
So and actually, in the same way that, you know, when we watched Hellraiser, we said they don't hold Pinhead back.
Yeah.
So you got the build up.
Mm-hmm.
That's fine, but at the point that they're in the house, Leatherface is there,
and that
bosh.
Is horror, and that was the scene that freaked
me out. And it's just
like yeah.
one.
It's how he shuts that door, yeah. you know.
But it's very matter of fact as well. This is sort of a precursor to that found footage kind of
yeah.
film, is it? In a way, there's a certain
well
naturalism to it. I'm just
yeah.
talking about when we first see Leatherface. So he's like going hello because they've run out of gas. He's gone to this house because they can hear. They've got a generator, so they must have gasoline. So
he's
going
to buy his gas with a guitar.
Yeah, he's going to get on the guitar and then maybe we'll come back.
Jerry's at Bell End.
Yeah.
Oh no, Kurt. That's Kurt.
And rude as well because they just go into the house.
Exactly.
He does. Well, Kurt lurks in and he's like, hello, hello, hello. And then just very matter of factly, Leatherface just turns up because Leatherface is probably making some
yeah.
sculpture because he's an artist.
Yeah.
And he just whacks him around the head. And then what I find terrifying is that there's this
a
metal shutter.
Yeah.
Shwam! It's like,
yeah, just said that.
Whoa.
Yeah.
I
but
wish
no, but just that metal
yeah,
shutter.
Yeah, no, me as well. That,
there's some functioning
also,
practicality
also the way,
to that door. It's like, that's fucking terrifying.
But also the way you never see a death shutter. And you see a proper death
oh,
shutter.
Yeah.
You do see one in The Rock.
I haven't seen The Rock.
I'm
when thinking
Sean
of the
Connery
actor.
Shoots the massive weight and it kills one of the soldiers and his legs just...
You're talking about a Michael Bay film which is actually quite enjoyable.
It's got Nicolas Cage in it.
Way after the Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
So
we're
just talking...
Cool. We're in 1974
cool.
right now.
So
the wind.
Also, I think most people know this already, but the production of this was hell, wasn't it?
Really hot, apparently.
Really hot, really difficult. All the actors were upset and traumatized all the way through. So I think that comes across.
Which is said to make for a good film. Because apparently, if you...
Well, a good horror film. I doubt it makes for a good rom-com.
No, but apparently they do say, like, if you've had a really enjoyable shoot, everyone got on, 9 times out of 10,
you haven't got attention.
It's a shit film.
Yeah.
So, this is another film based on Ed Gein.
Yeah.
Can you name two others?
It's a film based on who?
Ed Gein, the serial killer.
Serial ass bag.
Never heard of Ed Gein, no. Oh, come on.
No.
Anyway, can you name another two films that have been based upon that?
I asked you as well.
Devil Gremlins Wears Prada. 2.
Don't be stupid. You know the answer.
Oh, it's not that. Strangers.
Oh, no.
Yentl.
Psycho.
Oh!
Psycho's based on the character of Ed Gein.
Now. Oh, yeah, go on.
Go on, have you got the other one?
No, I was going to talk about the fact that there's Psycho in this film.
And Silence of the Lambs.
Ah, right, of course. Yes, 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 yes. But no, there is definitely elements of Psycho in this. So we're back to Leatherface. So I kind of get the impression that he's an artist. He likes making sculptures, stuff like that. I reckon he's probably the guy that went and dug up the bodies to make that sculpture.
Possibly. I thought it was the hitchhiker for some reason.
It doesn't strike me as much
could
of an artist.
Could be any of those fucking guys. They freeze.
But Leatherface, he has certain different masks for whatever thing he's doing at the time. And he's kind of like the mother figure, because there's a bit halfway through the film. He's mum, because he's making dinner.
Yeah.
And that's Psycho.
Well, he's not making dinner because the dad is the cook.
Yeah, he's the cook.
But he is dressed with the wig and his leather face.
And that's apparently what Ed Gein killed his mother and did all that kind of weird
right,
shit.
Right, right, right. So, yeah, that's Psycho. But there's also a shot of where, I've forgotten the character's name, where she's...
Pam?
Yeah.
Pam's the first one who gets killed.
Oh, no.
So Sally is the blonde.
Sally. So there's a shot of Sally's eye really close. Yeah. Beautiful shot of the eye.
Yeah.
But that just, I don't know why, but that it's just completely Hitchcock for me in a weird way. And again, that brought me back to this whole Psycho thing. But anyway, I'll shut up.
Which you didn't know there was any connection to.
Yeah.
Right, so, I put here, it's great they have someone with a disability in the film. Pity he's such a whining fuck.
I really liked him. No, you get an insight though, because they're all off exploring the house and he's just...
He would be frustrated.
They forgot
right?
him. Of course he'd be frustrated.
How selfish to make that poor woman push him through the fucking woods.
Yeah, that was... You're definitely going to die.
Yeah, yeah.
Definitely.
But he was saying, don't go. Don't go, don't go. But he had to go with her.
This is something that occurred to me. At what point, if we all went on a trip...
Depends who it is.
At what point, when one of us doesn't come back, do the other two go, he's dead, fuck it.
If it was Laurie, probably we'd just...
And that's what I would want you to do. That's what I would have wanted.
That's what you'd have wanted.
Yeah. But, you know, obviously the guy in the wheelchair is that disability. But also, again, I see Leatherface as he's just a fucked up kid that's been brought up in a fucked up family. And it's sort of that kind of
trauma. The grandfather's essentially, we believe, is the problem, right?
Oh, well, certainly from a makeup point of view.
Yeah.
You know, that makeup is awful and it takes everything else.
No,
hold on a minute. Everything else in that film, the design of all the,
the set.
The set and
all
the stuff that Leatherface.
Very realistic. Yeah,
brilliant. Then he comes along with that makeup and it's like, why? It just looks ridiculous.
I love it. And I'll tell you why.
Why?
This film unfolds, and I love the way it unfolds. Yeah. So, one gets killed, next one gets killed. Da, 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 da.
Like
we're left with Sally.
Actually,
we're left with Sally.
Oh, sorry.
We're left with Sally. All right. She manages to escape. She gets to the gas station with the toothy guy, who's fucking amazing and creepy as fuck.
Yeah.
Turns out he's a bastard as well. So the film's unfolding. You go back, we meet Granddad. Granddad gets brought down to the stairs.
Yeah.
And his makeup is kind of like old school monsters kind of...
Well, that's what I mean. I mean, I like the character, I like what he did. It just didn't look right.
I love it, because it gives it that sort of generational thing. It gives it, it kind of gives it that...
No, it just looks fake.
No.
What do you think with him?
So I liked it to begin with. So when she runs upstairs and ends up oh my god, I've run away from this dude with a chainsaw.
Yeah.
And I think I've reached safety, but I've actually entered the lion's den, a little bit like Eden Lake.
Yeah.
When she goes upstairs and sees him and the mother, I guess.
Yeah.
I thought it was all right, but I assumed he was dead.
Dead, absolutely.
Which is
mummified.
Yes.
And
yes,
then when they
yes.
bring him down. And the I get what you're saying, James, because the problem is when he starts moving, you can. It obviously is makeup.
Mm. Oh, no. It's just, it's great. I absolutely love the way he looks because I think it gives it even more, it opens up into a new thing. And that reveal as well, I completely thought he was dead. And they cut her finger and they put it in his mouth and he's like...
Yeah, but that all works. That's all brilliant.
Alive.
It's just the makeup.
Which reminds me of Seven.
Can we just
go
back
when
go back to Franklin.
Or Dracula, obviously.
Because I think you are right. I mean, it's not just, a one-dimensional character. Or two-dimensional? What do you say? One-dimensional, two-dimensional? If someone's not very dimensional.
How many dimensions?
Undimensional.
But, when he's having his like hissy fit.
One dimensional.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, I thought that was very good. You know, you kind of understand
when
he's
blowing
raspberries. He's always left out of things and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And they are fuckers.
And he doesn't say a word, though, does he? It's all through his physicality.
No, he does. He doesn't. And all that kind of stuff.
And
he
mocks them, yeah.
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 Oh, no, sorry. You're talking about Franklin again.
Yeah.
Okay. I just see Leatherface as this sympathetic. I obviously love him.
He's
beaten by his
man with a very profound learning disability.
Yeah.
You know, and a bit of a homicidal tendency.
Penchant for the macabre.
I've got a question.
Yeah. Good.
So you've run out of gas.
Yeah.
You've been to a creepy house.
Yeah. You bin me off thirst.
Yeah. You've then gone looking for a watering hole.
Yeah.
Which is dried out.
Yeah.
You then find, you hear the generator, and you go, get some gas from there.
Yeah.
You turn up, and how badly does that whole farm and that house smell?
Very bad.
Right?
Well,
so you bang
in the whole area probably stinks because of the slaughterhouse.
Do you think that's covering it? Because I'm thinking, there's knocking on the door, and how much do you think... If you're knocking on somebody's door, they're deliberately ignoring me.
Yeah.
And if I kick the shit out of this door, they'll realise I'm just a nice guy who just... I've got a genuine need.
And a guitar.
And imagine that awkward moment when you're like hiding from not answering the door and they walk in. It's like, oh, hi.
Oh, this is what we're doing now. I didn't have a question. I was just saying.
Yeah, that's fair point. Like, I probably wouldn't do that.
Let's get back to the start. Because, again, I don't usually like this when they say something's real and it's not. Or, well, the thing that really gets me is when they say it's based on a true story, and it's obviously not. But I like the way it opens, and it kind of says these events happened.
Yeah,
but it didn't, did it?
No, but it does give a certain amount of reality to it, which was quite good.
I don't think it's necessary, but I like the voiceover, it's fine. I like the kind of first setup.
But I think people did believe it was real.
Well, I think they did, yeah.
Yeah, like the Blair Witch kind of thing. Yeah.
Which is not needed. It's not needed.
It does add a different layer to it. But we had this conversation with the strangers around just saying it. But if you're making up the bit between two people exist and then they're dead and you make up the bit in the middle, then it has no power.
Yeah. And I think Strangers is not a good enough film for me to forgive it.
Agreed.
So it just pissed me off.
Agreed.
Whereas this one, I just ignore it. If it's an extra sort of PR thing, then fine. Sell the tape at the beginning. I don't give a shit. But what I do really love is the relationship of the three brothers. So you've got, the hitchhiker one.
Yeah.
Who's very... Almost, he does like sort of a magical thing, doesn't he? He takes a picture of Franklin because he doesn't buy it.
They should have paid him $2 for it.
He gets his silver foil out. He puts the Polaroid on the silver foil, a little bit of gunpowder, and burns the image of Franklin. So it's kind of a curse. So he's kind of like that witchcrafty kind of dude. And then you got Leatherface, as I say, this artist. And then you got the toothy brother, potentially the older of the three, who doesn't kill.
I thought he was the father.
I thought he was the father
because he got grandfather.
I did put a question mark next to that, but it was when he was calling grandpa as well.
Maybe just a brother. But that's a thing that people do, isn't it?
But anyway, dad, let's say dad then. I'd be interested to find out if he is a brother.
He's definitely the father.
Okay. So dad says, I just can't do the killing. He leaves it up to the boys to do it.
But he still enjoys it enough.
Yeah, yeah. When Grandad, they give Grandad a mallet, and they're saving Sally for him.
Yeah.
He's trying to bang her on the head, but obviously Grandpa has got no muscle left or whatever. See, the hammer keeps falling. But Dad's like, you can see Dad looking back, getting all excited from the kitchen. It's just like, I fucking love it. And their relationship with those three dudes, I fucking love it.
It's, that scene,
yeah,
because it's called the Texas Chainsaw Massacre,
mm-hmm.
you think the terror is going to come from the chainsaw, and it doesn't. For me, the really difficult scene is Sally when she wakes up at the dinner table.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And she just freaks the fuck out, quite rightly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it just goes on and on and on.
And you just can't see any way out for
it. And you just say, again, Jesus Christ. And then they go, well, we'll get this decrepit million-year-old man to hold a mallet.
Yeah. He's just been sucking her blood as well.
And it's just...
Back to the makeup, bad makeup. It's that Dracula thing, you know? It's kind of... It
works.
What
Dracula thing?
Well, no, just like the bad makeup, making him very pale and green.
Yeah, does bad makeup never works? It's always bad, isn't it?
And I've just realised that whole slaughterhouse thing.
Mm.
So you know they get killed one by one.
Yeah.
They kind of come into the chute like a cat. The cat.
Oh, goes, yes. Yeah.
And Leatherface just goes, poof, done.
Yeah. Yeah. So, when he hooks it up.
Oh.
You know, like on a meat hook, bit awful. I put here as well, when Franklin's murdered, it's a real jump scare. I wasn't expecting it at all. It just comes out of nowhere, doesn't
and
it?
And to be honest, you worked on a farm, you'll have heard chainsaws?
Yes. And they take a while.
You don't creep up on somebody with a running chainsaw.
Yeah.
You're hearing that from a... Do you hear some?
Yeah, Franklin definitely meets the chainsaw. I love... the ending... The imagery of the ending. So Tina's finally managed to break free.
Tina?
Sally. She's broken free for the second time. She gets to the road. This big lorry comes along. She kind of gets in. There's a funny bit where the guy that's driving the lorry, they
both
get
out
for some reason.
Yeah.
And they run round the lorry because he sees Leatherface. And he just starts pegging it. Very funny.
Why did they get out?
I don't know.
Yeah.
It's just really
drive
away.
It's definitely a question mark of the
because
film.
Because chainsaws cut through wood, not so good with metal. As is proven by the fact it's just taking the paint off his door.
Yeah, so they just...
I suppose it was maybe getting a little bit more action with Leatherface. Yeah.
But
happened to the lorry driver?
He runs off. So yeah, that must... Yeah, I don't know. Because he doesn't get in the back of the car. So another car comes along, Sally jumps in the back of it.
So he stops for her,
yeah,
and then he's probably dead.
Well, the lorry driver is running down the road. I don't know what happened to him.
Yeah, that's what
And it doesn't show a shot of him running down the road.
No. he throws a wrench at Leatherface,
yeah. He falls over, drops the chainsaw on his own leg.
Yes.
And then you don't see him again.
Well, you see him run off stage right. Yeah.
Maybe I was.
He went that way in his orange shirt. Hmm. But then, as Sally's driving away, like hysterically laughing, back to this kind of art stuff, you get this sort of dance from Leatherface where he's just swinging, he's furious, he's swinging around the chainsaw, and then it ends. And it's just. What a film. The Texas Chainsaw Massacre can easily be put into that sort of, oh, it's just a horror slashy gore film, you know.
No, I think it's something more than that.
It is a masterclass in making people think they've seen something that they haven't seen and had this just amazing unfolding experience, high tension experience, and it's just done perfectly. It's a work of art.
It also managed to do something that Midsommar failed to achieve,
right?
Which was create a horror film. The first 47 minutes are in broad daylight.
They are. Mm. Yes. But I suppose what with Midsommar is slightly different. It's like blistering light. It's really light.
Yeah. Not very good.
Yeah. Shall we score it?
No. Well, okay. Just because you've wrapped it up doesn't mean we have.
Go on then.
Okay. So I just wanted to speak about Leatherface's voice. Sounds like a mixture of a child and a pig.
Yes.
Yeah, because he's squiggling, isn't he?
Yeah. And I liked all the references. You know, you saw the cattle, you know, waiting to go into the slaughterhouse and all those... Keeps going back to that.
Yeah,
it is a good advert to for vegetarianism, really. That film, it's horrible.
Yeah, it is.
And again, going back to this idea that he's a victim, he's really panicked at people coming into his house.
Yeah, they're missing the shit.
Yeah, he didn't want them there.
I think it's a film about friendship as well, or lack thereof. Yeah. Because Sally, when she and Franklin are left at the van,
yeah,
and she's with Jerry,
yeah,
Kurt is with Pam,
yeah.
We know that Kurt and Pam, they've gone to the waterhole. We know they're dead or as good as.
Yeah.
Sally, when it's gone dark, she's there going, "I'm not leaving without Jerry. Fuck Kurt and Pam. I'm not leaving without Jerry."
Yeah.
So again, this all comes into the protocols you need if you're going on road trips in the States with your friends.
Yeah.
Who are you willing to cut loose immediately?
Well, we've established that.
Yeah.
Because then, you would have just said, Jerry, fuck them. Don't worry. Don't go and find Kurt and Pam. They're probably dead.
Would you go, though? You'd have to.
You'd have to go. Of course you would.
Yeah.
But would you wait until the morning?
No.
I'd probably drive and get help. That's the sensible
thing. You've got no gas.
Yeah, well, some gas.
Got some gas. Enough to drive. Oh, right.
Yeah, they took the keys.
Hotwire. You can hotwire things in the 70s.
Yeah, they did take the keys.
I think this is one of the first films as well where they got the colour of the blood right, I think. Because it wasn't until the 70s, was it?
Well, like, you barely see it, so...
I obviously did, because I wrote it down.
Yeah.
Right, I think that's about...
I think the old man, that scene when Sally has escaped from Leatherface, he chases her to the petrol station.
Yeah.
Meets the old man.
Yeah.
Who then bags her, puts her in the footwell of his
car. Hits
her
with a broom.
Just pokes her with a broom all the way back to the house.
You'll be okay. And the light that's on his face, and it's just... Yeah. Obviously, that realisation of what that character is, it's just perfect. Perfect, 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 perfect.
Okay.
So I'm going to score this fucker high.
Just a little bit about locations. Texas. I've been to Texas.
Well done.
Cool.
Okay.
That's it. I used to eat Texan bars, one of my favourite confectionaries.
I've never heard of a Texan bar.
You never had a Texan bar?
No.
Are you sure you're not thinking of a lion bar?
If there's
or a wagon wheel.
Would you play the Albert
now? No.
Texan bars.
Any memorable lines? I haven't got any, actually.
No. There's a lot of screaming, quite rightly.
No, there'd be loads of really good ones, but I can't think of those. No.
All right, is that everything?
Yes.
Shall we score it?
Yes.
Mm.
Okay. All right, so performances. Win.
I've gone for 3.
Oh.
Which sounds hard, but...
It really is harsh. It doesn't sound hard. It is harsh.
Performances, 9.
9 for me. Had they... Nice.
Don't worry.
Who was bad? Who was badly acting in that film?
All of them. That's why they get a 3.
Go on. Anyway.
Effects.
9.
8 for me because of my grandfather. Plot, 8.
I'm going to... 7.
8.
Do you know what? I write my scores down beforehand so people aren't influenced. I'm not influenced
by
people.
That's a very, very good point.
You know? I write mine down beforehand and then I'm influenced by people. Okay.
Just to let you know I'm going in heavy. This is a really good film.
Oh, I might bring my scores down.
Absolutely, by all means do that if you feel...
Rewatch factor, Laurie.
8.
9.
3.
Direction, 9.
9.
7.
It wasn't your go.
Sorry.
Cinematography, win.
7.
9.
9. Sound of music, Laurie.
10.
6.
6.
Music's fucking great in this
film. No, it's not. It's about 6. Originality, 9.
7.
8.
Enjoyability, win.
5.
9.
9. And life-changing past or present, Laurie?
It's superb. 7.
9.
0.
Oh my goodness me. Did it not have an effect on your life?
No, I only saw it like 15 years ago. I was already grown up by then. So, yeah.
Well, no, maybe you don't understand the question.
Or maybe I'm interpreting the question. And we're too deep into this now for me to change how I interpret that question.
Fair enough. Right, so I've given it a score of 85.
Jeez. I've given it a score of 52. Laura's going to compensate.
Jesus Christ. I'm just watching him do his arithmetic.
Did you get like a Montessori school?
I don't.
Because that's not how I...
No, you're really, really throwing me off!
He's just put numbers
I know.
Randomly on a page and...
76.
Jesus. I could do that in my head.
89.
I don't believe you.
Me neither. 16.
25, 34, 44, 52, no 61, 68.
No, it's 68. No, it's 80.
It can't be 68. Did you count this one?
Oh, no, I didn't see that. And that one.
There's two nines
68,
in there.
68, 77, 86.
Which is similar to yours.
So bump that up to a 9. 89.
No, it's 86. What's the point in doing the scores if you don't use them?
It's 86.
Okay, how many of us are there?
Three.
And that one. Have you never noticed that one?
Which I actually looked in. And that gives us an average of 74.3 recurring.
It needs to be higher.
Good score.
Where is it?
Well, this is what I'm going to have a look at. All right, so...
You need to get a paper that you can't hear it. Do they do that yet?
Why?
Or I could wear white gloves, maybe.
You should do
this
that.
This is a
like
visceral experience for our listeners.
Yeah.
Well, that's true.
Right. Seems like you're obsessed with sound effects. Mm. You know, that's a free one for you. Right. So, on our 2019 leaderboard, it puts it third, just under the Candyman, which is a perfect spot, I think.
Yeah,
and just
bad.
Above.
I think it trumps Candyman.
No, it doesn't.
Yes, it does.
Don't our schools say differently?
And Hellraiser.
And in our overall, it goes along exactly the same as a Dark Crystal.
See, what I've actually done
right.
by my... And I've only just realised this wasn't my intention when I started. Mm. But what I've done by my interpretation of life-changing is I've really heavily weighted the films that I like. Because if they have changed my life, they get 10 scores from me instead of 9.
Well, I think that's what we've all been
That's
doing.
The point, though, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I'm just realizing the impact.
We've just realised you don't like any of these films.
Yeah.
All right. So that's it. We're just going to move on.
I'm going to kick the table over.
So our second film of the month is Death Wish. So let's have a clip.
Enjoy a typical afternoon in New York City.
Hey, Mother.
My name is Paul Kersey. How's my wife?
I'm sorry. She died a few minutes ago, Mr. Kersey.
Any chance of catching these men?
There's a chance, sure.
Just a chance.
I'd be less than honest if I gave you more hope, Mr. Kersey.
This is Paul Kersey. This is the story of a man who decided to clean up the most violent town in the world.
Right, Death Wish. It was also released in 1974. Director Michael Winner.
Oh, Michael Winner.
Calm down, dear. Written by Brian Garfield. Music, Herbie Hancock.
Oh, brilliant.
Box office, $22 million with a budget of $3.7 million.
Really?
Yeah. It was a massive film. Massive film. Sequel spin-offs, 4 sequels, 1 remake.
Mm.
Quite recently, the remake as well.
Yeah.
About the remake, so that's by Levi Roth, what it is called.
Right.
So he did like Hostel. He's not good.
He's a torture porn guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, torture porn guy.
Look
and
at us
Bruce Willis.
Things up.
Yeah. I mean, obviously we've got
opinions.
Don't
just throw this together, mate.
Bruce Willis has done some good shit, but no. So basically,
have you seen it?
No.
Well, you can't call it.
And I have no ambition to see it.
Okay, so notable actors. Charles Bronson as Paul
Charlie
Kersey.
Bronson.
Yes, Charlie B.
Hope Lang? I don't know. As Joanna Kersey. Vincent Gardenia as NYPD Lieutenant Frank Ockhart.
He's great.
That'll do, won't it?
Yeah.
That will do.
All right. So, first memories. I've never seen this film before.
Why did you choose it?
Because it's one of those films that you know, stands out.
It is kind of into cult status now, isn't it?
Yeah.
Deathwish. Do you know
absolutely.
And it's, yeah, if out of all the genres, obviously it fits into that cult, but it's just, yeah, it was just, it came out of left. I never would have thought you'd pick this. I'm glad you did.
Well, there we go. It's not quite the film I thought it was going to be.
No?
No. I don't know why I thought that.
Yeah,
can't remember what. Exactly, I can only remember the film that I've seen.
Exactly the same. So I do have a memory. So my mum was a massive Charles Bronson fan.
Oh,
massive.
Did she have very bad taste in actors?
He's a great actor.
Is he?
He's very. He's great.
Okay.
Anyway, so yeah, she was really big fan of his, and I remember mum talking about this film, saying like, you know, this guy lives in this apartment block, and the people. Really naughty, and he's pushed to revenge and stuff like
naughty.
That with a gun.
Well,
you know, I was pretty young.
Okay. Were you in your sailor outfit?
It would have been circa sailor outfit.
Oh, we've got to put that on the website.
Nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, people go to
the Facebook.
The Facebook page and you'll
and
have that little treat. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You'll have a treat right there. So, yeah, she was a big fan. So she told me about it and, like, the gun thing. So I imagine it being very much shooty uppy kind of stuff. So,
it is quite shooty uppy.
I think this is the first time I've ever actually watched it in its full entirety, and I didn't realise it's actually going to be as interesting, the subject matter itself, as what it turned out to be.
And how about you?
So I think I'd only seen about half of it before. Having watched it now, I thought I'd seen it all, but it would have been, I don't know, again, 15 years ago, something like that. Saw the first half. Apparently, Louisa tells me, this was her dad's favourite film.
I really?
Yep, absolutely loved it.
Well, it was a massive film of the day.
Because Charles Bronson kicks ass in it. I don't know.
Yeah.
He looks bloody good in his long.
It was also very controversial, was it? Which we'll talk about later.
That's what's really interesting about this film. Yeah. We'll obviously discuss it as we go along, but it's not.
Do we like
it? Clear line.
Yeah.
Very much so. Yes.
Yeah, I think I like it as well. It's a very 70s film.
Yeah,
it is.
Give us the synopsis.
No, you give us the synopsis.
Okay.
Ever since you presented that one time, you have just gone a little bit power mad. Just remember who's in charge here.
It's because my belt's too tight.
Go on, synopsis.
Right, okay. So you've got Charlie B and his beautiful wife laying on the beach. Beautiful beach. Charlie looks great. The guy is ripped. He's wearing like these beautiful little shorts. He looks brilliant. Very relaxed, wind in his hair. And anyway, so they come back from their vacation. And then
I'm going to change it from synopsis to opening scene. Because he goes into such a lot of detail about the opening scene.
Him, his daughter and his wife go to a grocery store. You basically get the feeling that New York, at the time, I believe New York actually was like this. Bit of a
crime-ridden.
Yes, but I don't think every time you walked out of your door, you were going to get mugged.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that kind of premise sets up. So the youth are dangerous little bastards. And these three particular bastards basically follow them, and they notice their address is on their groceries, because the groceries, because there's quite a lot of them, because they're quite rich and well-to-do, because Charlie B is a really good, cool architect.
He's an accountant in the book.
That too. And he... so they've got money. They've basically got money. So these punks follow them back home, pretend that they're delivering the groceries. They burst in. You get this awful scene.
No, they don't pretend they're delivering.
Yeah, they do.
Oh, they do, yeah.
Groceries,
yeah, but that's
now.
Not how they get in.
Yeah, and that's why she opens the door.
But they go up the back stairs, which are obviously very under protected, secured.
Yeah.
That's the Achilles heel.
They pretend to get, and the reason why they get into the apartment is because they pretend they're delivering the groceries. You get this awful, awful scene. You get the pleasure of Jeff Goldblum's backside, though. The only redeeming feature.
All right,
of that
yeah, that's not. You're just talking about the whole film, and we'll have nothing else to talk about. So his family are tortured, terrorized, and his wife gets killed, and it flips him over the edge. And he goes on a revenge killing spree.
But not straightforward. He doesn't go straight to revenge. He basically follows
that
character.
No, hence the film. All right, so opening titles. I've written a fucking weird. What happened in the opening titles?
What was the opening titles again? Remind me.
I can't remember, but
I didn't make a note about them.
I think it was the music and the way they just.
So Herbie Hancock's music, love a bit of Herbie Hancock. Yeah. That's proper like. Wah, wah, yeah. Wah, wah.
Where it gets really jazzy in bits, like.
And actually, because I really like Herbie Hancock, I was there going, "Oh, I can't wait for this." And there were a couple of bits where they're going, "Not sure that entirely matches the scene I'm watching."
Yeah, yeah, absolutely right. I think,
but it's good music.
Yeah, yeah. There's a bit where he's walking down by like the quayside or wherever he's walking, and obviously Herbie Hancock's great jazz musician, but he goes probably a little bit too far into avant-garde jazz for that particular scene. Mm. It gets a little bit tasty.
Yeah, sorry, I wasn't listening to you. I think this film feels very British, even though it's set in America.
Right.
And I think that's probably to do with Michael Winner. Well, just kind of, if you think of the other films around that time, from the 70s, it just has a very British feel for me. I don't know why.
I didn't see that.
No, I didn't.
Okay. I didn't see that.
Also, I just get the feeling that Michael Winner just decided, oh, well, let's go and do a shoot in the Caribbean for a week. And let's, you know, all this kind of stuff.
Well, it was Hawaii, wasn't it? Or it was supposed to be Hawaii.
Okay, I don't know.
But, yeah.
Somewhere hot.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was expecting, obviously, because Michael Winner and kind of what our opinions are of him, I was expecting it to be, like, you know, junky and rubbish. However, I think he does quite a good job, albeit he is kind of painting by the numbers. But again, as I say, it's just.
Well, I don't think it is in 1974. I don't think there was a film that had been like this before.
Yeah, but I mean, painted by the numbers, I mean, like, you know, you've got the three punks that are introduced at the beginning lurking around the back of the van.
It's a bit vaudevillian.
Yeah, exactly. That kind of feel. And like the graffiti, there's one of the fucking.
Why would he
wankers.
Be. He clearly can't fucking graffiti.
He just does these shit squiggles. Yeah, man, I'm really gonna fuck you
and
up.
A swastika?
Just,
because we're fascists?
That looks stupid, doesn't it?
Really stupid.
Also, yeah, the things that, like the nuns.
Yeah, so I've actually got a note here. So the mother and the daughter get attacked.
Yeah.
Mother dies. The daughter is raped.
Yeah.
Yes, I think so.
Yeah.
And she reverts into herself and she's admitted to an asylum, essentially.
A sanitarium, I think.
Sanitarium, run by nuns.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I've just put, nun rehab, fuck off.
Yeah, they're the worst.
It's just,
sort of people.
No, absolutely not.
Also, they were wandering around at the start,
they were,
weren't they?
Very suspicious.
You know, like.
They were almost like the
carrion.
Yeah, they were almost like the cover for the three hoodlums to break in.
I think that's probably Michael Winner thinking he could be an
artist.
He's
got a thing for nuns, isn't he?
Well, what did the wife die of?
A kick to the head.
Right.
So it wasn't as graphic a beating as we would expect nowadays, but essentially they were saying she's been assaulted to death.
Yeah. She was assaulted to death.
So this isn't necessarily in flow with your line of chat, but
yeah.
I thought Jeff Goldblum's hat looked a bit like a Christmas pudding.
You definitely had notes of that.
What do we think?
Without the holly on top.
Yeah, what do we think of his performance?
Well, those three of them, actually the big skinheaded guy actually was the most downplayed of the three hoodlums.
Yeah.
But they're clearly, the backdrop to this is crime-ridden New York.
Yeah.
And the assertion, or the kind of inference for those three is that they're jacked up on something, because Jeff Goldblum is definitely playing a wild-eyed and frenzied kind of a character.
Yeah.
But he's all right. That
yeah,
part,
well.
His performance there got him the fly.
Oh, cool.
Did it? Not, But it was his first performance, so it probably got him Invasion of the Body Snatchers.
Yes.
Yeah, which is really great. And it gives a uniqueness, doesn't he, does our Jeff Goldblum. However, so that, obviously, that takes Charlie Bronson's character now into, obviously, he's lost his wife.
Yeah.
His daughter's, like, in a, basically, she's in this weird kind of
but you
coma.
Can't blame her for being that jittery, because there's a bit in it where someone's just leaning over her while she's asleep.
Her husband,
ugh.
Jack.
Yeah.
Now, he's a disappointment, isn't he?
Yeah, wet fish.
And he what do you call your mother-in-law, Laurie?
Nini.
To her face.
Nini.
Nini, okay? You were a bad example. But
oh, yeah.
He calls
Dad.
He calls him Dad.
But see, hardcore. My mum and dad used... My mum used to call my dad's parents Mum and Dad.
Right. I think it's cute.
I find it really disorienting.
Yeah, I don't. Yeah.
And, you know, my wife calls my mum and dad... Mum and Dad. Liz and Martin.
Yeah.
Because that's their names.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, it would just...
I think it was something that happened.
I guess it was
though.
A thing back then.
Definitely it's a thing that's happened. And I suppose what it does, though, works quite well because it gives him and the son-in-law that connection. It just connects them a little bit more. Because they're going through, obviously, the daughter, she's like comatose, basically, for want of a better word. And they're desperately trying to kind of get her help, and that's not working. So Charlie B is obviously, he's torn. He gets this opportunity to go away from New York, the toilet, as they call it,
and they even say you're a bleeding heart libertarian.
That's it,
because it shows that change from being, you know, a real pacifist.
Yeah. Yeah. So he goes away to Tucson to have some time to think, and basically the guy that he's working with out there is obviously he's a gun lover. He's that, you know, what were they
cowboy
called?
Cowboy and...
It seemed a little over the pioneer. Top to go all the way there to do that. He could have done it himself.
Well, this is what I think it makes it interesting.
I think the point is he was helped on that journey. He needed help.
Yeah, with it to going away to present. Hey, are you but leaving? Here you go, here's something fun for you.
But it also gives reference to, you know, a comparative to what New York is.
Yeah.
So New York is this toilet cesspit, you know, everyone's robbing everyone. The frontier, as it were, because this is what this guy links to, the gun. Yeah, and this is a big thing about America.
Yeah.
This fear. He talks about fear. And we've had enough, man. We're going to take our own. We're going to protect ourselves with the gun. And this is all going into Charlie B, the libertarian's head.
And he's a conscientious objector when he served in Korea.
Absolutely.
He's not from that. And there's a reason. There's,
his dad was a hunter, and he lived by the gun. His dad was the gun, but his mum wasn't.
Because his dad got killed
in a hunting accident. Yeah, so he decided to go with mum. So this is where the film starts getting interesting. It starts going into that American psyche, gun, pioneer, fucking bullshit, if you ask me. And then this guy, Charlie B, picks up the gun, starts shooting it, and as a gift... The guy that he's working with, he gives him a gift, and Charlie B unknowingly goes back to New York with a gun. Looks at some pictures.
Could do that these days, could you?
Looks
well,
at
I
some
quite like the fact he says, you're checking this bag, right? Yeah. Okay, good.
So Charlie B goes back, some Polaroids, some pictures have arrived from Boots, and he opens them up, and that's him and his wife on the beach. Charlie's looking
great. Well, he used
the
whole film just on that bit on the beach, didn't he?
And then he unwraps the present, and there's the gun.
See, that's the thing. For me, it's about if you have access to a means of recourse, fear will drive you to that.
Yep.
So he's just terrified and scared, and he's had enough, and he's had all this loss, and a means to an end is put in his hand. It's not like he's gone to it.
Yep.
It's come to him. But now that he has it, He's not going to be taken advantage of again. But even before then, he put some quarters in a sock.
Yeah, he was building towards that,
wasn't he?
He was
building towards some kind of way of...
Yeah, but it's not revenge, is it?
Well, no, it's revenge. To begin with, the thing in a sock is like, no, this is I'm not going to be intimidated in my city anymore. Mm. And then with the gun, it becomes revenge.
Yeah, but, I mean, with that thing, you don't actually see...
There's no resolution, is there?
In a normal, straightforward, standard film, you would see the three guys. Yeah. But no, it's not. He's basically going out.
I think that was a good
choice.
I think that was
fucking great. Yeah. So that's what this film is actually very
interesting. I wonder if they turned up in Death Wish 2.
Guaranteed. It would do that kind of stuff. So he basically starts deliberately taking these night walks.
And being deliberately... provocative with showing loads of money in his wallet.
That kind of comes later, but on his first outing, as it were,
He
goes to bad places. Herbie Hancock lays on a little bit slightly too spacey jazz.
Yeah.
And then this guy comes up.
This is in his heroin phase.
Yeah, and he pulls a gun on him. Charlie B turns, caps his ass, goes home and violently vomits in the toilet. But now that's it, he's crossed the line.
All right, can I just say something about his performance here?
Yeah.
Is he an actor or just a man saying lines?
He's the latter of the two.
Yeah.
Which makes
he's like the Arnold Schwarzenegger of his day.
Yeah, he's just cool.
But he and he is cool.
Yeah, he's cool.
Like, oh, he is cool.
Everybody else looks a bit shit.
Yeah.
Like all the suits don't fit properly or maybe they do, but they're not wearing them very well. But he manages to look cool in the stuff he's wearing and the coat he's wearing and that ridiculous moustache somehow.
And that ridiculous tie, and he still looks fucking...
Somehow, he looks pretty cool.
I completely get why Mum loved him.
And he is also one of film's natural runners.
I'll tell you what he did do well. Mm. I can't remember this, but his whiskey drinking is inspired, apparently.
Although, you can really see Michael Winner's taste through this film.
Go on.
The 70s decor is revolting all the way through. 70s was. But the tumblers he's got have got those little gold filigree bits on them.
Yeah.
It's all a little bit much. Bit Michael Winner.
No.
And then when he redecorates, does he paint it red or something?
Orange.
Jesus.
Do you like what I've done with the place? No. It's just as bad as what you had before.
Well, you're talking about the drink. So again, they use that as a kind of a device for this film. So he's basically a milk drinker.
Yeah.
He's a milk drinker.
Oh, yeah.
And then the son says,
I've never seen you drink without food.
Yeah, exactly. So he's very much a stand-up guy, but that sort of deterioration, that perversion of the character, they use drink as a thing in it.
Mm. I think the plot is brilliant.
I think it's very
interesting. You know, the way the media get hold of it and, there's a little bit of a crisis
So then that's a big thing. So obviously New York is riddled by crime.
Well, this
crime,
is why
crime.
The film is so controversial because...
Yeah.
The backlash. Well, they're worried about the backlash that people are going to do this for real. I think a few people did.
Yeah.
It was heavily criticised.
Is Death Wish, I've got here, is Death Wish responsible for the increase in gun crime in the US? Because in this film, throughout, none of the muggers have guns until the last mugging.
No.
So you said
first one has a gun. Actually, virtually all of the muggins, there's
no,
a gun.
Don't.
Yes, they do.
No, they don't.
Yes, they do. Right,
no, they
first
don't.
One pulls a gun on him.
So, the first guy does, yes.
Yeah. Yeah. And the second one, there's three guys.
You're holding up three figures.
Yeah, but they've got knives and a lead pipe.
And one of them has a gun.
I didn't see the gun.
Yeah, it is.
All right, well...
And then...
So, the two black guys in the subway have got knives.
Black guys in the subway, yeah, they're both knives.
I don't think the three...
Yeah, one
knife.
Of them has a gun.
I certainly do think it did.
Did it increase America's buying of guns? I think it's
yes, because
they don't need any excuse. Any excuse they could fucking
it's,
think
it
of.
Is, yeah, feels
it's
like
on
it's
their menu.
Yeah, protecting myself. And that's kind of their whole philosophy about it's not very cut up that his daughter gets committed.
Well, yeah, because I think the son actually comments that, though, doesn't he? He's like,
oh, he goes out for dinner, doesn't he?
Oh, yeah, I saw it the other day.
I went yesterday, he says. Oh, no, I know she is, I went yesterday.
Yeah.
Well, how can you be so... What, do you want me to just wallow? How do you like your liver? I don't particularly.
Yeah.
What actually made me think is, like, liver.
My mum used to cook liver and onions for Dad.
Yeah.
Not for us.
My mum used to make liver and onions. Disgusting.
So... We've all hosted parties.
Yeah.
There's a maximum number of people you can get in a house.
Apparently.
Paul, when he throws his party...
How many can you get in a mini?
How many parties?
No, how many people? Have you ever seen all
the
phone
six,
box?
Six
you get quite a lot.
A
yeah, no, but you know what I mean? To make it... The fact that Paul's party, everybody's having to stand on the stairs because there's too many...
Oh, right, yeah, yeah.
Just saying, too many people. Paul's a dick.
Do you think Paul was trying to find another wife at that party?
Could have been. I didn't trust Paul because he was the one who said you should just round them all up, put them in concentration camps.
Oh, was Paul the son-in-law?
No, that's Jack. Paul was the partner in the architect firm who, him saying we should round up all the criminals and put them in a concentration camp was to demonstrate that Charlie B is a liberal.
Right, okay. Mm.
You also get in this film, so obviously you've got the police detective.
Yeah, and he lives in Little Shop of Horrors.
Oh, yes, he is.
That's the domestic.
Yep.
Yes, of course he is. So you get to sort of follow their approach of how to figure out who this person could be. And they talk about, obviously, the fact that he's a really good shot. So maybe people that are served veterans, stuff like that. Maybe someone that's had a crime happen in their family. So that's a you following that police detective, trying to figure it out, is a really nice part about this film as well. Yeah,
and then you get the politics.
Yeah,
that say, well, you please dissuade him rather than arrest him.
Yes,
we don't want to make a big martyr out of him. We don't want. Yeah. Yeah. We want to keep a lid on it, even though crime figures have dropped. Street muggings have dropped because the muggers are now scared.
Yeah. Is that why? Because they scare him off. Because
they were
going to
arrest him. Why did they warn him an hour before?
Because they weren't going to arrest him.
Right, okay.
So that when Mr. Mushnick goes to City Hall, meets with the mayor or whoever,
yeah,
he effectively gets told, you can't arrest him, we can't put him on trial, because he'll raise the profile and other people will start doing it.
Yeah.
Right, that's
we
it.
Do want him to stop, but... So he goes, okay, I'll scare him off.
Yeah, get him out of town. Or they almost implied as well, kill him and keep it quiet.
Yeah.
That kind of thing. They were alluding to that as well.
But he's quite ballsy, Charlie B.
Yeah.
Because he gets stopped by the police outside his apartment.
Yeah.
Having left his gun at the office.
Yeah.
And in no way is he going to be dissuaded. He's going, oh, I'll just wait 5 minutes and go out the back.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, nobody checks those backs there now, like, we know that. I can't remember this either, but I put here, the performance of the doctor at the end is truly unique. Anyone remember the doctor?
The performance of the doctor?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, he speaks in a...
I'm in prison!
It's like that, because Charlie's
Carter!
Been... Charlie's been shot and he collapses and he's in hospital, isn't he? And he's got, he's got a weird, weird voice.
Don't remember that.
So after that, he does leave town, doesn't he? So this is kind of like the final sequence.
Yeah,
and he flies to Chicago.
Yeah.
You see him get off the plane and...
And there's a woman, a young woman at the reception, at the arrivals hall, who gets a little bit roughed up by four thugs.
Four thugs.
And he's like, oh yeah.
And you get that cool shot of Charlie just pointing his finger like a gun. And
that's great.
And it ends.
So,
great.
Just talking about effects, the pictures on the piano look like professional headshots. You know, there's not really a lot of thought in there. Yeah. I said about the graffiti as well. I don't think I've ever seen a snowy funeral before.
Oh my
snowy,
God!
Yeah. And the thing is,
Michael Winner must be a bastard.
He
to
had
make
him out
them
there for ages. Because how covered in snow was Charlie B?
You look at his back, and he's been obviously standing there for freaking ages. Yeah. He is covered.
Yeah. Although it doesn't take long to cover you in snow.
He's covered.
Oh, okay.
I did quite like. Also, there's a bit after the funeral where he comes downstairs, and there's people with balloons and supposedly like, hey, this is fun. And they let go of the balloons and evidently the shot is supposed to be a gentle wafting up and it's obviously blown a gale because they just go straight off out of shot.
I think there was a bit of a budget constraint on the cows. They only had three cows.
Yeah.
How much did you say budget? This was 3 million.
Yeah.
Yeah.
3 million.
Is that a lot or a little? I don't know what you mean when you're saying 3 million.
For
like
1974, that is loads, and that's not on the screen. Money is not on the screen.
It's all in Charlie B's pocket.
Michael Winner's pocket in the whiskey glass.
It's his marble leopards.
Yeah,
massively.
Michael Winner loves a zoom shot.
He does love
a
zoom.
There's a lot of those going on.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And this was before they got Blood Right. So we can now pin it down to sometime in 1974.
When the mugger who may or may not have a gun is going up the chain link fence and he gets shot in the back and it's clearly just a sack of orange, red, whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah. This was also a point in history where business people had glass dishes of sweets on their desks.
Yeah, I think they should bring that back.
Yeah,
maybe. Have you seen that in films anymore?
No.
I have a question. Why does the inspector have a cold?
I don't know. Maybe you just had a cold.
You get these little quirks, don't you? A lot of the time it comes from the actor.
And did the inspector, did the detective have a cold in The Exorcist?
I seem to remember him blowing his nose. But, you know, you get these little quirks. Sometimes actors like to go, I see my character as having a neck scarf. Or, you know, having a twitch. Something to do. And I think it just gives it a little detail, doesn't it? So I like the cold. That's good.
All right, memorable scenes. Yeah, I've got, it's not memorable, it's the wrong word, but the rape scene's quite strong, isn't it?
Oh, yes.
It's
horrible.
Yeah.
It's horrible.
Anything else?
I like, I suppose, like the gun when he first is, he's sort of reintroduced to the gun, and there's a moment before he touches it. The music throughout this film is very sort of like organic instruments, but there's this weird kind of electronic, which is quite effective just as he touches and holds the gun. So that's kind of cool.
Did it stand up today?
Surprisingly, I think this.
I put surprisingly.
It does. It does. And do you think this film falls on either side of pro or con?
What depends on what you mean by pro or con.
What the character that is doing. What
well, that's
does.
Why it's so controversial.
It's morally incredibly
dubious.
Dubious.
Yeah. Because
do you think the film though falls either side?
I know it's very supportive of him taking matters into his own hands.
Do you think it's pro?
Pro vigilanteism.
Yeah.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Well, not necessarily pro-vigilante. That vigilante is probably a bit strong.
Not only does he get away with it, he's given, like, just carte blanche. You just walk.
Well, everyone's cheering him on, so of course.
And he's got the public behind him because the little old black lady who fights off the muggers with a hatpin.
Yeah.
He's like Batman.
I think maybe you're right. Maybe that film is pro. Oh, no, maybe I've given it too much credit.
Yeah,
because I think there is a real, you know, divide. There is a real conflict in it. I don't think
is. We see the conflict from the point of view of the police and stuff like that, but the hero figure who everyone loves and follows is Charles Bronson.
Yeah.
But I don't, that's what I say. I don't think it's strong enough as, I don't think, what I got at the, maybe I'm, like I said, I'm giving it too much credit, but I didn't realise it was really going, that he is a hero. Oh. He's a bit fucked up. And that last shot when he does the finger, I think it's terrifying.
Yeah, but picture your parents going to see that, and they'll be coming out of the cinema going, yeah, look what he did at the end, he's going to get those motherfuckers.
The problem with it is that it is focusing just on that bit, and it doesn't, you know, in a balanced society, you have to look at, okay, well, look, crime is really high, why is crime high?
Yeah.
What are the stresses and pressures on this class of society that mean they have to go and break the law?
Yeah.
It is implying that it's just a choice and that people kind of go, yeah, fuck it, why not?
Yeah.
As opposed to all the real origins of that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And therefore it removes the need for conversation. It just says, they're bad, shoot them, done.
Yeah. And I think you are actually right. It does lean more pro. But interestingly, this film was originally, there was a guy called Sidney Lumiere. I've totally said his name wrong. I'm so sorry. He did Serpico with Al Pacino.
Yeah, it's a good film. That.
But he was set up to do this film, and the character that plays the character Charlie B plays was originally going to be Jack Lemmon. So much more kind of meek.
Jack Lemmon was going to be
Charlie B.
Wow.
Yeah, so that gives you an idea of what that character.
Yeah, I think someone else turned it down as well. Someone else quite famous. Because it was very controversial.
Yeah, so you've got like a real everyman, whereas Charlie B is a little bit more cool. So he is a little bit more of a gun-tooting, da-da-da-da. But, you know, Jack Lemmon, you know, that's really the sentiment. Right. That's this material of Death Wish, you know, Brian Garfield's novel, whatever it is. It's definitely, it's that divide. Do we, don't we? It's that line. And
All right. So, memorable lines. I've got a few. Take it easy, Dad. I'm just as rattled as you are. He was clearly not rattled when he said that line.
Yeah.
But we've been waiting a long time. It hasn't been that long.
It's been three minutes.
That's true. Yes.
What the hell do you want me to do? Moan and groan for the rest of my life?
Yeah.
That's it.
There's a nice interchange between the two policemen when they're sat outside Charlie B's building.
Uh-huh.
The detective has sent the weird-looking fella off to make a phone call. When he comes back, he says, is this poor Kersey the kid? I ain't going to ask any more questions. And then the detective says, go home. I don't need you. And the other guy goes, weird.
With a tear in his eyes. Yeah. Massive tear.
Weird.
All right, is that it?
That's it.
All right, let's.
And although I would question Charlie B's decision making.
In what way?
In that final mugging.
Yeah.
You got three men, two with knives, one with a gun. Shoot the man with a gun first.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Just saying.
The script told
him. He got carried away.
The script told him to shoot the guy with a knife.
All right, let's score it. Wyndham, kick us off with performances.
Performances, 5.
Five.
Two. Effects, Lloyd.
Four.
Two.
Three.
Plot, eight.
Six.
Nine.
Rewatch factor, Wyndham.
Three.
Five.
One. Direction, Laurie.
Michael Winner, you little twat. You spent £3 million. You bastards. Three.
You know that's all on food and restaurants. That's all you used to go on. Four for me.
Five.
Cinematography, two.
Five.
Five.
Sound and music, Wyndham.
Eight.
Seven.
One. Originality, Laurie.
I'm sorry, I've just given it eight because it's Herbie Hancock. Even yeah, though it doesn't really apply in places. Sorry,
jazz. Originality, Wyndham. Laurie.
It's not necessarily originality, but just what it's exploring I really like. So, seven.
Well, it's quite an original concept for that time.
Yeah, six. Yeah.
Six.
Enjoyability, Wyndham.
Five.
Six.
Seven. And life-changing past or present, one.
Zero.
Three.
God, you've even undercut me with that.
54.
Oh,
34. You were doing it as you went along. 34.
34, and I gave it 46. 34.
46.
Yeah.
You know how I did that?
Yeah.
I've got that Hermione Granger...
44.6,
which kind of takes away the whole point of the whole film. If yeah, you think you could, you it know, does, you could stop anything happening. If
it's
you've got
the best film, though.
What was it?
44.6.
44.6. So this year it puts it quite low, below Blood and Satan's Claw.
Is it really?
Yeah.
Yeah,
Blood on Satan's Claw is good.
But above,
you quite like this one as well.
Battle yeah, Beyond the Stars, and overall. Page two. Oh. 44.6. Below Romper Stomper and above In the Mouth of Madness. So there quite good, really.
Yeah.
Well, there
well done,
we go,
guys. Group hug?
That's no. That's 1974 for you. So, Laurie, it's
finally
your choice. It's
finally it is happening.
5 months.
Brilliant.
Yeah, it must be.
It feels like a long, long time.
Yeah.
Right, hold on. The all the port.
Come on, James's yeah, ticket.
Yeah, come on, my golden ticket.
Yeah, no, I like them.
Right, dig deep.
Give it a chuffle. Do you proud? And that proudness is all the fives. 55.
Okay, it's another year.
Ooh. Oh, damn it, I didn't want a year.
1957.
Ooh, okay. Well, hey, who would have thought in 1957? Really pretty punchy year. What you got?
Such a dick. You don't look. There's no point in you looking at the film.
No,
that ruins the whole point of
no,
this
it's
episode.
Fine. I am going to love what you've offered. Come on.
All right. First one up is The Incredible Shrinking Man.
Are you serious? Are you sure that came out in 1957?
Yeah.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Right.
Are you being sarcastic?
No. Hmm. Wow. It's even better than I thought. Jesus. Okay. Carry on.
You probably was looking at the wrong year.
So, I wrote three because I thought that was...
Brilliant.
I also put that one. But
okay,
I am going to suggest, because I love Quatermass and the Pit,
ah,
I'm going to go Quatermass 2.
Oh yeah, I very nearly chose that one, but I didn't.
Do we know if it's the same guy as the Quatermass in the Pit?
We do not.
We don't know?
No.
Okay.
Roulette.
Shit. My second choice, a bit more traditional, but very good film nonetheless. 12 Angry Men.
Oh, such a good film.
Mm.
Oh, man.
I am going with Curse or Night of the Demon.
Yes, you are! Right. This is, oh my god, I'm so pleased. Right, 100% The Incredible Shrinking Man.
Yeah.
And Curse of the Demon. Yes! I am so chuffed. Yes! These are both.
All right.
I don't think we've ever had that reaction from him.
Tell us a film
that you saw. That's.
I saw the sweet smell of success, Paths of Glory, The Curse of the Demon. Bang! 10 points. Seven Seal. Oh. I never realised The Incredible Shrinking Man was in there as well. Oh. And 12 Angry Men.
There we go.
Wow.
All right, so that's it. Goodness, for another month. Our next month is our Christmas special.
We're doing these the next episode, though, right?
Yeah, we're just wearing Christmas hats.
Yeah, Christmas hats.
Oh, okay.
And there's a couple of little surprises as well that I've got lined up. Nothing too exciting.
Do you have a couple of bonus episodes? I mean, around Christmas, just a flag. So Mark Gatiss has...
Gatiss.
He's doing a Christmas ghost story, isn't he? So why am I talking about it now? I'm not quite sure.
Yeah, talk about the next one.
Yeah, okay.
Wonderful. All right, so that's it. Goodbye.
Thanks, everybody.
See ya. Oh, I'm so chuffed.
Lighthouse. We went to see Death of a Salesman, which was very good.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, was it very good, was it?
Yeah, but about 4 days afterwards... ceiling caved in. Did you hear about that?
Oh yeah, was that Death of the Salesman?
Yeah. And you know what I was thinking before it started, even though it's my favourite play, it's like, oh god, it's so long. I wonder if something could happen that would stop the play.
So you've just got a 4 day delay.
Yeah.
Wow. Mm. Do you know, I don't even think I remember what Death of the Salesman is about. Is it about a salesman who's not very well?
Yeah. Huh. Mentally ill. And he was slightly overacting his mental illness.
Who was he?
The guy from The Wire, black guy from The Wire.
Wendell Pearson?
I don't know. We haven't recorded the episode yet.
We're going to go and see Cyrano de Bergerac.
So are we.
With James McAvoy.
Oh, why?
He's in everything.
Cyrano de Bergerac.
Have you seen the press photo?
No.
Where he's leaning up against the mirror and he's looking at the camera in the mirror.
Oh, I think so. But I don't hate him as much as I hate, what's that guy who I don't like? He played Moriarty in
shows. Oh, I think he's Scott.
Oh, he really annoys me. Really?
He's quite... He redeemed himself with Fleabag, though, didn't he?
No.
Did you watch Fleabag?
Yeah.
I haven't seen it.
Yeah. Do you know what? All it... I know it's great. Everyone loves it. It's a very good series. But all it is like Miranda on cocaine.
Yeah.
That's all it is. And, very, you know, very much everyone's so. Saying this is nothing like it's been on before. Miranda, 2 years ago. You know, so there we go.
Yeah, but cocaine does mix it up a bit. It does change things.
Absolutely.
Gives an edge.